Very good afternoon to all, and welcome to this webinar on genome editing in agriculture, potential opportunities and way forward in Bangladesh. This webinar is a knowledge initiative focused on developments in gene editing and the need for enabling policies in Bangladesh so as to make technology in order to meet the urgent need for improved crops. The webinar is being organized jointly by the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, South Asia Biosafety Program, Agriculture and Food Systems Institute, and Biotech Consortium India Limited. We are really overwhelmed by the interest in this webinar by the audience. We have got more than 300 registrations, and we have very esteemed speakers with us from Australia, USA, India, and Bangladesh, all who would be sharing their wisdom with you all this afternoon. Without taking too much time, I would now like to introduce Professor Haseena Khan, who is the secretary of the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, and invite her for the welcome address. Dr. Haseena Khan is a professor at the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology, University of Dhaka, and is, as I said, currently serving as the secretary of BAS. She was awarded the Independence Day Award, the highest state award given by the government of Bangladesh for her contribution on research and training. Thank you, Dr. Haseena, for initiating this webinar, and over to you for giving a formal welcome address. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, greetings from the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences. Mr. President, Emeritus Professor Dr. A.K. Azad Chaudhary, Vice President Dr. Zed Karim, Dr. Patella, Dr. Bansal, Dr. Roberts, Dr. Ahuja, Dr. Zeba and Khadim, the other panelists who are present, fellows of the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences and other distinguished participants. We have participants from the government, from the academia and students, and from this different institutions. Good day to all of you. I'm going to briefly tell you a little on the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences. It was established in 1973 with 12 foundation fellows. It is the premier scientific body of the country, unique in dimension and character as compared to such organizations which function as societies and associations. The academy currently consists of 57 distinguished Bangladeshi scientists as elected fellows, 20 as expatriate fellows, and 11 eminent foreign scientists of international repute as foreign fellows. This academy is administered by fellows elected from among the most distinguished scientists with some very little financial support from the government. It works as the scientific think tank of the government, and this resource of talent and expertise is harnessed in the broader public domain as a consultative and advisory body to the government on many scientific matters. The academy acts as a focal point to many international organizations like the International Science Council, the Inter-Academy Panel, the Association of Academy of Sciences and Societies in Asia, the World Academy of Sciences, and others. This academy supports champions of different national Olympiads to attend the World Olympiad events in different countries of the world. And we also organize Science Olympiad each year. And the academy, in collaboration with the International Network for Advancement of Scientific Publications, has been making available e-books and e-journals of world-class publishers to the scientists, teachers, researchers, and students of all major public and private universities of Bangladesh. And the academy has also made available scientific research publications of Bangladeshi scientists to the scientists of the world through the online website BanglaJol, Bangla Journal Online. This supreme scientific institution works to enhance the efforts of promising scientists by recognizing high caliber scientific activities in Bangladesh. And in order to achieve food security and poverty alleviation, the academy has been granting research funds to the scientists of Bangladesh through the BAS, we popularly call the Bangladesh Academy of Science BAS, through a BAS USDA, US Department of Agriculture Endowment Research Program. We usually get a few projects on gene editing using different technologies. Therefore, in this background, this webinar on genome editing in agriculture will allow us to understand the evolution of genome editing technologies, especially the application of the third generation ones, to achieve a number of plant breeding objectives of for food security and poverty alleviation within the regulatory regimes adopted by Bangladesh. Let me end by thanking Professor Zeba and Dr. Ahuja and Dr. Aponna. Thank you for taking this timely initiative. And I thank the Academy of Science Secretariat for sending invitations to many of you individually. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Ahuja.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much. Before proceeding further, I would just like to briefly introduce the structure of the webinar and a little more about the supporting organizations. As Madam has already briefed you about the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, I would like to take this opportunity to share with you the activities under the South Asia Biosafety Program. South Asia Biosafety Program is a project which has been underway in Bangladesh since almost 2005 with an objective to put across, to strengthen the regulatory systems, help the governments and the other stakeholders, and undertake a lot of biosafety capacity building system, biosafety capacity building activities. Biosafety capacity building activities. Agriculture and Food Systems Institute is the organization which implements this program in Bangladesh, and also we have activities in India. My organization, Biotech Consortium India Limited, we support this program and act as the senior advisors. BCIL has been associated with the SABP since inception, and for the last 15 years, we've been closely associated with so many activities in Bangladesh. So this is all about the supporting organizations, and I will move. I would also like to thank here all my colleagues here, Mr. CM, Dr. Leila, Ms. Leila Tarar, and Aparna also, who has been helping us in these activities. Now, moving on to the structure of the this webinar, I'd just like to briefly mention to you that we will have four presentations. This will be from after the remarks by the president, we will have the presentations on the basics and the advances on genome editing. Though the focus is on agriculture, the webinar is on agriculture, but we thought it will be useful to you, useful to have a glimpse of what all the gene editing applications are in healthcare, and we will have a presentation on that, and followed by Dr. Zeba Saraj talking about the gene editing for crop improvement in Bangladesh, and moving on to the regulatory part. So this is going to be our structure. We would be, this will be followed by the panel discussion by the very eminent, all our Bangladeshi scientists on the need for enabling policies for the use of gene editing in Bangladesh. Before I give the floor to the president, I would also request all the participants to kindly post their questions in the chat box. Depending on the availability of the time, we will pick up those questions and have the discussions. Alternatively, we will get back to you with your answers. So this is just a very, very brief overview of how we are going to go about doing it. And now I would like to invite Professor Dr. A.K. Azad Chaudhary, President of the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, for his remarks. Dr. Abul Kalam Azad Chaudhary is a Professor Emeritus at the Department of Clinical Pharmacy and Pharmacology, University of Dhaka, and the current President of the BAS. Just before, you know, we were in this chat, Dr. Haseena was telling us that University of Dhaka is celebrating 100 years, and that's how sir is very busy. Thank you so much, Professor Chaudhary, for taking out time and joining this afternoon. Dr. Chaudhary has served as 23rd Vice Chancellor of the University of Dhaka and the 11th Chairman of University of Grants Commission. And he has been included, he was included in the Queen's New Year's Honours list, receiving the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire for services to education in Bangladesh. Thank you so much, Dr. Chaudhary, and over to you for your remarks. Thank you.
Okay. It's my proud privilege to welcome you all to this international webinar on genomic editing in agriculture and the prospect in Bangladesh, food situation and other things, you know. This is a wonderful opportunity for Bangladesh Academy of Science to host this webinar, one of the partners, and there are other three partners in this process. And it is a wonderful opportunity because all of you are working in a cutting edge technology which can really revolutionize our need, safety, security, and the future use of the food and agriculture, all the items are. You see, the global population is rising, though not exceedingly, but it is rising. And in few years' time, they're meeting the food demand and all sorts of food demand is a challenging prospect, a challenging problem, you know. And for Bangladesh, it is all the more problem because we are having undue share of the natural calamities, drought in winter season and flood and deluging in the rainy season, salinity of the sea level rise, and sometime infestation. These are the problems our farmers face, our agriculture sector is facing. We have got a lot of success stories in agriculture. While our population was about 75 million, 7.5 crore, we had a lot of problems feeding the people. But now we have got 17 crore, that is 170 million population, which is a huge number compared to the landmass, but we are more or less self-sufficient in food. And that is due to the innovation, technology, and deployment of those technology in the agricultural field. For a country like this, it's a densely populated country, agriculture will remain a challenging factor, you know. Given the situation, it will be more challenging. To meet these all the challenges, one way out is the genomic editing of editing in agriculture sector, be it in the oilseed or in rice or in wheat or in the fruits and things, you know. This is really a revolutionary idea. Two people got Nobel Prize back in, they started working long before, and 215 they have contributed those things. And one is Jennifer and the other is French gentleman, they got a Nobel Prize for CRISPR-Cas9 editing. I am not in field of agriculture, but I'm a biochemist by training and my work is in pharmaceutical chemistry. So I have got some knowledge about the CRISPR gene editing system in animal system, more or less in the human cell, which is not applicable in lab stage, it is not applicable in animal cell, it is trying and a lot of things are doing on this factor. And I think this sector can meet the challenges of the growing infestation, infection, and aging diseases, Alzheimer's. These things are the clue, or the genomic editing could be the clue to cure of all those things. I can give you little statistics. In United States, every year, four to five, at best 10 drugs are permitted for marketing. This is a breakthrough. If it is a 10, it's a big number. But in biotechnology and genetic engineering product, biosimilar products, that they get a permission about 30 to 50 drugs in a year. That speaks a lot for the success. Many of the challenging diseases of this age and era are being met. Now the people are thinking the cancer will be, at least genomic editing could be in some sort of cancer will be controlled, and they are virtually breaking the age of it, you know. And Alzheimer's will be, which is a serious disease, and number is soaring. Some people estimate that about $700 million to $1 trillion worth of drugs are being used for this. They are also things as Alzheimer's. The question of answering this all requirement of the brain diseases, genomic editing, special care, CRISPR, Cas9, Cas12a, those things could be applicable and they are trying it animal model, in the rat model, and they're getting a successful response. I'm not very, I don't know much about, I know a little bit about agriculture. Our agriculture, I mean, in our country, sometime fungus infestation, especially wheat is a serious problem. And there are problems. Some of our colleagues have been working on the saline resistant agriculture, especially the crop, rice. I think we have seen in the literature that discovery of stress resistant, drought resistant, salinity resistant, and environmental resistant rice are now in the in the experimental stage, and some are marketed also. There are cases where the grape seeds, oil seed, they are also stress tolerant varieties are evolved due to this genomic editing. Genomic editing has a huge prospect in either in cell system or in the isolated way or in the field level, in the agriculture, in human and other conditions. And the trick is that the CRISPR Cas9 case is generally utilizing the CRISPR system of bacteria used to against the virus. So the idea is innovative, and a lot of things are being done on this field. And I know most of this by name, I know most of the participant and the contributor here. I've got some experience of Queensland while I visited about 20 years back. They are very good in biotechnology and genetic engineering, because one of my favorite subjects was that while I was a vice chancellor, we introduced that discipline in Bangladesh, Dhaka University. Their Queensland graduates got Nobel Prize, though he's working in America, Nobel Prize on the genetic engineering things. So we take pride in the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology of Dhaka University. They're doing excellent work, and Professor Hasina Khan is the highest award-winning scientist working on the genomics and genomes. Our Jawa Islam Shiraz is doing an excellent work on drought-resistant, saline-resistant varieties of the rice and things. They are case, and our Tawajjul Islam also worked quite good. We were there in Nottingham University. He's a Nottingham University alumni, and it did a lot of excellent work. He's a good fellow and doing this thing. And our in genetic engineering biotechnology department, Khatimul Islam is also there. He has been also doing a lot of good work. I believe this souvenir will open up new vistas for scientists of the South Asian countries. They're doing an excellent work, but government in most of the countries are a bit restrictive about use of this. I think this sort of seminar will open up the window, having more exposure to this sort of medicine, drugs, foods, additives. I know there are regulatory provisions, some are regulatory provision in USA, in Argentina took a lead of this. And in America, it is restrictive, though there are some ways you can go. In India, it is encouraged, but not to that extent. In Bangladesh, as I gather, they are trying to explore the possibilities and getting the permission from the government so that this genome edited products can change this food situation and face the challenges of the global explosion, and more so in Bangladesh in future time to come. I'm really looking forward, and all the successful veneer and their contribution in this field will be a landmark for the addition of the new discoveries, new exposure to this field. This technique and technology and great cutting edge technology holds future for future generation. Of course, there is risk. I don't say that there is no, it's a totally risk-free. Environmentalists always agree against it, but it's not all true. There are some problem. There are some problem, or maybe some problem. That is why they categorize the on the basis of the application of the technology. Some are on the basis of the product they produce. Some are on the basis of the general idea of combination. But whatever may be the case, there is a challenge for the global civilization to feed this population with all the things and to meet the challenges of the diseases. So we have to get to this new technology and use this for the mankind. And I think that is a commendable job our biotechnology department is doing, biomolecular biology department is doing, and agriculture university is doing. I'm very proud to have introduced my vice president, or our vice president of Bangladesh Academy of Science. Jorul Karim is a celebrated scientist. She was in charge of research and development of all the agricultural products. She's here also, here participate and will contribute. I see Abdullah Islam from the University, Tamina Islam from here. And I also see, Hasina Khan will talk about this, our contribution. And Jawa Islam Shiraz will probably give a big presentation. I wish all of you success. I'm sorry I will not be here for long because I have to watch this delivery and break through things. I'll go through those things in the papers and think. This is a challenging job. And it's a trickery and it's a very delicate issue that has to be solved, addressed, and future way out should be found in this. Thank you. Thank you, other sponsor. I thank our celebrated scientist, Hasina Khan, to take a lead in the cooperation. I also thank our colleagues from Bangladesh and colleagues from India and from some of the companies. I see Andrew. I know it's Andrew Robert. I know Andrew Young, but Andrew Robert is a good name and he's a good scientist, I think. And I wish Ajha Biva Ajha, who is also a co-sponsor of the project. And so I wish all the success of the veneer that will open up the new windows for cooperation, collaboration, and long journey. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for your very, very encouraging views on the ideas on the immense potential that gene editing has in healthcare and particularly in agriculture because of the challenges being faced in Bangladesh. So thank you for your time, and we will now move on. Our first presentation to the series of presentations that we have planned for the webinar. So the first presentation is by Dr. Jimmy Botella, who is a professor of plant biotechnology from the School of Agriculture and Food Sciences, University of Queensland. Dr. Jimmy is the head of the Plant Genetic Engineering Department. He specializes in the fields of tropical and subtropical agriculture biotechnology, has several patents in the field of biotechnology, founded companies, and is a member of scientific panels and won numerous awards. Thank you, Jimmy, for agreeing to host it. And I would just like to share here that Dr. Jimmy made a presentation a few days back in one of our webinars, and it was so well received that we got requests from Dr. Zeba as well as some other friends that, you know, they would like to hear Jimmy again, and his way of explaining the basics of gene editing has been so good and were very, very well received. Over to Jimmy, and thank you for taking out time to be in this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahuja. Let me share my screen. Before I get started, I want to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to address this forum. It's a pleasure to be here. I do have quite a lot of collaborations in Southeast and East Asia. Today, I'm going to talk about genome editing. Of course, I'm an agricultural scientist, so I will concentrate on agriculture. I'm going to have a look at my watch to make sure that I don't go over time. And let me start with this. I'm not going to start talking about genome editing. I'm going to start talking about mutation breeding. Mutation breeding is something that has been used by humans for a long, long time. From the very beginning of agriculture, mutation breeding have been there. And as a matter of fact, we do have the first example in a book, in a Chinese book called Lulang, that was written in the year 300 before Christ. So look at this. This is really the first documented example that we have of selection for breeding. a farmer goes through the field and sees one plant that it looks better than all the other ones and decides not to eat that plant, but to keep the seeds for the next generation. That's has been happening for a long, long, long time. Now, in the 30s, we discovered that we can actually help nature by doing artificial mutagenesis. You do artificial mutagenesis by subjecting, you know, seeds to either chemical or physical mutagens like, you know, radioactivity or neutron bombardment, and chemical agents like, the famous Agent Orange that actually produces quite a lot of mutations. Now, using artificial mutagenesis, today we have more than 3,000 commercial plant varieties that have been released. And these are not 3,500 plant varieties. This is commercial plant varieties. We're talking things that are being commercialized, that are being sold in the supermarkets in 228 species and in 72 countries, including Bangladesh. Now, if you look at the distribution here that I have on the right-hand side of this slide, you will see that the vast majority of it has been produced, commercialized, and released in Asia. So there is plenty of these mutation varieties that are being consumed by humans. Why am I talking about mutation breeding? I am talking about mutation breeding because the basic genome editing is no more and no less than mutation breeding, with some differences. And the difference are that, you know, in mutation breeding, you can create anything between 10,000 to 50,000 mutations in the genome, while with CRISPR, you can introduce a single mutation if you wish. Instead of random, like mutation breeding actually produces random mutation, CRISPR can actually produce the mutation in an extremely precise way. Instead of all over the genome, like happening in mutation breeding, CRISPR can produce that in one single location. If you wish, you can do it in two locations or three locations, but you can select the number of locations where you produce your mutation. Instead of having to produce hundreds of thousands of lines, you can actually do that by producing four or six lines. You don't need any more than that. That actually have a secondary message, that is that you do not need quite a lot of personnel and it's a lot cheaper to do. And instead of having to do multiple generations to weed out the mutations and only keep the ones that you want, think about it. If you got 50,000 mutations or 10,000 mutations in a plant and you only want one of them, you have to backcross quite a lot of times, all right? Now, let me remind you this, because mutation breeding is not regulated, meaning you have more than 2,000 in Asia. We have more than 2,000 in Asia. And when you do mutation breeding, you are not subject to, you know, all these striking government regulations. CRISPR is no more and no less than mutation breeding, but with extreme precision. Now, for those who are not familiar with genome editing, and I've been told that we have a mixed audience here, so it's important that you understand the concept, the technical concept, that you would not believe it, how simple it is. I'm going to talk about CRISPR and Cas9 because they are the most common system used. Let's say that you want to produce a mutation in one very specific part of a chromosome. Well, what you use is a molecular scissors, that is a protein, plus a homing device, that is a small molecule of RNA. But the molecular scissors is what the most common one that we use is Cas9, it's a protein called Cas9, while the homing device is a molecule that is normally called sgRNA, single guide RNA, or sometimes just gRNA, guide RNA. And it's called a guide RNA because it's going to guide your molecular scissors, your nuclease, to any place you want in the genome. Let's say this is a chromosome. Let's say you want to create a mutation right here. Of course, you know the sequence of your gene. So what you do is you design the homing device with a sequence that will bring your nuclease straight into the right position in the right chromosome. And of course, once the nuclease is in the right position, it's gonna cut. And the chromosome will produce a, what is called a double strand break. So what you have is a broken molecule of DNA. Now, this, believe me or not, is not so uncommon. Lots of cells, lots of times, happens that the DNA is broken, as for example, you know, UV. UV light will produce this kind of double strand breaks. So we have a number of repair machineries in the cell. And most of the time, that repair machinery will come into position and will repair the problem, and you will see nothing whatsoever. So things look like new. But every now and then, the repair machine will actually come into position, try to repair it, and will make a mistake. Now, that imperfect repair will create a mutation. And that is what the basic CRISPR technology aims to do, create mutations in a very specific part of the chromosome. But don't get confused. CRISPR is all about this. It's all about being able to take the nuclease, the Cas protein, into a very precise place in the chromosome and cut that molecule of DNA. The rest is done, is perfectly natural, done by the natural repair machinery that we have in every cell, in animals and plants. So CRISPR is about cutting here and introducing mutations. I'm going to give you a very quick example of how precise it is and how good it is. In this case, it's about creating sticky rice from normal rice. Sticky rice is very popular in Asia. You use it for food, or you use it to make desserts. And essentially, the normal rice versus the sticky rice only presents a mutation in one single gene. So, you know, genome editing is the perfect tool to say, all right, can we create sticky rice, you know, by introducing a single mutation? The gene is called the WOXI gene, and this is the structure of the gene. You see there are a number of exons and a number of introns in the gene, and we targeted this particular position in the first exon of the gene, and this was the sequence that we use in the guide RNA to target the nuclease Cas9 to the right position. This is the chromosome, as you see it over here. This is where it's supposed to cut. And the precision of this is such that I'm gonna show you some lines here. You know, in this case, this line, when the repair was made, an adenine was introduced into it. In this other line, a cytosine was introduced into it. In this next line, a thymidine was introduced into it. And in this one base was deleted from it. In this one, there were more than one base, and in this one was a big deletion. But as you can see, the cut and the introduction of the mutation is extremely precise. Now, this other one is another line. We did two lines at the same time, 9522, and XS134, and you can see here, this is where it's supposed to cut, and you can see the position of the mutations in this particular one. Two bases were taken out in this particular one. A few bases were taken out, but you can see that it was extremely precise. Now, when you look at the plants, and you look from the gene edited and the normal plant, or the mother plant, gene edited and mother plant, you don't see any difference. You look at the seeds, you don't see any difference. You look at the yield and you don't see any difference at all. You look at the composition of the seeds, and the amount of starch was exactly the same for all of them. What did it change? It changed the quality of the starch. This one had low amylose content that will make it sticky once it is cooked, while the mother plant did not have a much higher amount of amylose. That is one single mutation in one single gene. Of course, you can look at the seeds. You know, the seeds actually look different. They're a lot more whitish if you cut them in half, and you can stain for amylose. And you see that the mother plant has a very strong staining because it got a lot of amylose, while the waxy plants or the sticky plant, rice plants, have a much lower amount of amylose. Now, that was done by introducing the CRISPR-Cas9 into the genome. In the next generation, we had a number of lines. You see 1, 2, and 3 lines here that do not contain the transgene. This is the other variety, and we have 2 lines that do not contain the transgene. This is the T2 generation. So what did we do? We did an ultra-fast breeding on an elite rice variety going from a normal rice to a sticky rice, and we did everything in 2 generations. And I'm going to tell you a bit of a secret. We did it in a single year because we grew the first generation in 1 region of China and the second generation in a different region of China, and we were able to do it in 6 months plus 6 months, 1 single year. That is amazing. That cannot be done any other way. By the way, you say, you know, what about any other mutations? Well, look, in plants, if you take into account that you introduce 10 to 20,000 mutations by random mutagenesis, whether you introduce only 1 or you introduce, you know, 3 or 4, wouldn't actually be a bit of a problem. But we did sequence the entire genome. We did not find any other mutations there. That also allows us to transfer knowledge that we have in 1 crop to another crop. For example, now we are transferring the knowledge that we have in rice to sorghum, because whether you like it or not, you know, their grains, they're very similar. The genomes are relatively similar. And so what we're doing is getting QTLs from rice and we're putting them into sorghum to try to reproduce the same mutations that are beneficial for yield in rice. Again, that would not be possible with any other technology, but it is relatively simple with CRISPR. That was the simple CRISPR technology. We have a number of new things coming up. Well, this is essentially, it's almost impossible to keep up with, you know, what is going on in CRISPR because there's so many people working. So we have new Cas. I told you about Cas9, but there are a number of new Cas available today. We have new CRISPR technology like base editing, RNA targeting, epigenome modification, prime editing, and even gene replacement that are being developed as we speak. I, of course, I do not have time to explain all this technology, but I'm going to just stop in 2 of them. 2 of them that are very important for plant breeding. One of them is base editing. Remember that sometimes you want to introduce a mutation in the gene, you stop the gene working, and then you get a phenotype that is important for you. But many things in agriculture is not about knocking out a gene. Many things are about 1 single base pair change. It's what we call single nucleotide polymorphism or SNPs. So many QTLs depend on 1 single change in 1 single nucleotide. And what base editing allows us is that. It's a bit of a trick because the Cas protein in this case have been modified to, instead of cutting the 2 strands of the DNA, it only cuts 1. And then it has been artificially fused to a citidine deaminase that is an enzyme that will take the amino group from the citidine. Now, when you take the amino group from the citidine, it's converted into a uracil. And the uracil, after, you know, the DNA is synthesized and replicated, is changed into a T. And that T, now you have from a C, you have changed into a T. And of course, from a G, you have changed into an A. That allows us to change a C to a T or a G to an A. The other base editing system is what we call the ABE, adenosine base editing. The adenine base editing does exactly the same, but it changes an adenine. Now, in this case, Cas has been fused to an adenine deaminase that will take the amino group out of adenine that will convert it into an inosine. And that, after, you know, synthesis and replication, is changed into a G. So there you go, an A for a G. What kind of practical consequences of this? I'll show you a couple of papers. They're not mine, but they are very interesting one. These people actually introduced herbicide resistant in a watermelon variety that was not herbicide resistant. And they did it by base editing. They changed 1 single base in the gene. And here you have these melons are actually resistant to this herbicide. This is another example with maize. Again, one single base in one single gene, and all of a sudden you have herbicide resistant maize. Again, that can be done with, you know, random mutagenesis, but think about the amount of work that it takes to do that. While in here, it's essentially almost too easy. And the other one that I want to tell you about, and I'll finish with that one, is the latest one. It's called prime editing. That allows us to change pretty much anything we want, anywhere we want. Let me explain this. The guide RNA that takes the nuclease into position, in this case, is a bit longer, and it has two domains, all right? At the 5', you have the targeting domain, that is the place, is the part of the guide RNA that will bring the nuclease, the Cas, into position. At the end, you add an extension of the normal guide RNA that you will use for editing. And you will understand this in a minute when I show you how it is done. What happens is you fuse your Cas9 to a reverse transcriptase. And the Cas9 is modified in a way that it only nicks the DNA. So what happens is Cas9 comes into position, it nicks the DNA, and this part of the guide RNA is complementary to the DNA strand that you have just nicked. So this is easier to see. You can see here that you have nicked the DNA. I'm not showing either the Cas or the reverse transcriptase to be easier to see, but they are here. And the Cas have cut this. This is the guide RNA. This is the end of the guide RNA. It actually binds the bit that you have just nicked. And here you have the template for whatever you want to produce. This is DNA and this is RNA. Your reverse transcriptase will copy this molecule of RNA and produce a molecule of DNA by copying it. Now, what have you done? Now you have your DNA is a bit longer than it was at the beginning. And as you can see here, it's a bit longer than it was. So it doesn't really fit. But you know, there is a process called flap equilibration by which this DNA will displace the other one, will come into position. And once you have the DNA replication, now what you have is these red bits, these the bits that you wanted to introduce. That could be one base, it could be two bases, it can be more than two bases, all right? It can be anything you want. You can put it in there with extreme precision. And an example is this one, where you see that this particular gene and the ACC1 gene, it was targeted, and the normal plants have a G, while these plants, edited plants, have a C. The consequence of this G to C, and let me explain this. This G to C is not possible to do with base editing. Okay, with base editing, you can do a G to A. While with prime editing, you can do any modification you want, all right? Now, that single nucleotide change will actually introduce herbicide resistance. And this is the wild type plant grown with herbicide, and this is the gene edited plant grows with herbicide, all right? So that's the end of my presentation. I'm more than happy to answer the questions while we are in the dialogue at the end of this, all right, not now. Also, if there is someone who wants to produce collaborations like that, we're always open within the limits that we cannot travel so far, all right? And my final word is just telling you this. Genome editing is like mutation, but with precision. And remember that random mutagenesis have been used to produce more than 3,000 commercial plant species. Thank you very much. I will stop sharing my screen.
Thank you, Jimmy, for such a wonderful details about the technology and also the new technologies, new advances with prime editing, base editing, explaining it so well. We'll get back to you with the questions and for the time being, move on to our next presentation. And next presentation will be, again, as I said, small component has been added about the healthcare applications. And we have Dr. ABM Mohammed Khademul Islam from the University of Dhaka, Associate Fellow of BAS, who would be delivering about delivering this presentation. Dr. Islam, as I said, is a professor in the University of Dhaka. He has been working in this area, and for his overall outstanding contribution to the biological sciences, he was awarded as the Young Scientist Prize Award from the World Academy of Sciences and Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, and also the Samson Memorial Award. Over to you, Dr. Islam, for a presentation, and I would request all the speakers now onwards that we have understood about the basics to kindly keep it to the time as we so that we can get some more time for the questions. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Biba Abuja. Can you see my slides?
Yes, we can see you and also hear you very well.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I will be actually more giving examples of CRISPR-Cas and other genome editing applications in healthcare systems. So CRISPR, apart from the CRISPR-Cas, there are other genome editing tools are there that is being used for a long, like gene finger nuclease, ZFNs, and also TELN. And now CRISPR-Cas is actually mainly playing the role because of its easiness. So there are lots of applications of this genome editing tool from the basic research like functional screen, living live imaging, chromatin interaction, generating models, or gene knockout, gene knock-in, substitution, regulation, and also making different types of therapeutics, and as well as making diagnostic tools. CRISPR is actually now a good as a diagnostic tool. So in earlier, in 2000, traditional gene therapy that we have seen, but now we see CRISPR-based gene therapy. For example, in 2007, we see the first CRISPR germline editing implemented in human embryos in China that gave lots of controversies and uproar. But later on, there are more clinical trials of CRISPR clinical in immunotherapy, cancer therapy, and treatment of blindness and other diseases. So CRISPR is actually can be used to any disease or any viral bacterial disease that is related to gene. So any in theory, any genetic disease can be treated by CRISPR-Cas or other gene editing system. So in CRISPR-Cas, we can actually edit this nucleotide, we can detect, we can use it for diagnosis, we can make a cell model, animal model to study the disease. We can apply this knowledge to well-being of human for the clinical practice. We can make a new drug, new therapeutic applications, not only for epigenetic or transcriptional applications. We can also apply this to change in the embryo and in the fetus, and as well as in the plant system. So there are many applications of the CRISPR and other gene editing technologies. In this short time, I cannot give so many examples. I will give a few examples. Let's start with the how CRISPR can be used for as a diagnostic tool. So CRISPR can be used for detecting infectious and non-infectious disease. Any change in, for example, any mutation can be detected because there is a single guide RNA that is very much specific to detect any nucleotide that is made for it. So there are CRISPR-based chip that is a biosensor that can detect these specific genetic mutations. I can give an screenshot that we can put a small sample here, and this guide RNA will be complementary to that mutation or any change in the DNA. And in this case, this enzyme may be deactivated one or maybe leveled with something so that we can see the signal of this binding. This is the, how the chip is made. And there are other very promising technology that is called Sherlock that is developed in MIT. So here we can detect DNA or even RNA. This is from this DNA or RNA in vitro transcription is made. So this DNA can be detected using the guide RNA. And also we add this reporter signal. If this guide RNA can bind this, for example, if a viral DNA, if it is a viral DNA, if this viral DNA is present in my body, this guide RNA will bind and the enzyme will be activated. It will start chopping this DNA. It will not only chop this DNA, also it will chop the reporter RNA. So we'll see the signal from here. This is the way chip has been made, a bedside strip, very easy to use diagnostic kit has been made, which is already used for detecting of several viruses like Zika, dengue. So actually CRISPR is going to revolutionize the diagnostic system in a time coming where consumers might be able to go to their local drugstore and pick up a CRISPR diagnostic test to test for major diseases. This has been also tested in this global pandemic, SARS-CoV-2. SARS-CoV-2 already actually detected by CRISPR techniques very rapidly, less than 40 minutes. This guide RNA is actually tagged with a reporter gene, so we can detect it easily in very short time. And this is very sensitive. It's a very good agreement with RT-PCR result, like 95% positive and 100% negative in as compared to the RT-PCR. So CRISPR is already also used in disease model that I already said, widely tested in animal disease model. It's actually tested to restore the hearing mice, also genetic blindness, and not only in rodent and several other models it is used. How it is used, we can actually take sample from the healthy donor and with the help of CRISPR, we can switch on or switch off the gene for making the iPSC, pluripotent stem cells. So we can make a pluripotent stem cells, and then we can change the gene, edit the gene, we can delete the gene to make a disease model. When we study the disease model and we are sure which genes to correct, we apply this knowledge to disease donor. We make a pluripotent stem cell, we correct the mutation, and then put back these cells to the disease donor. This is the, how we treat the patient. So CRISPR has an enormous role in curing the disease. I am going to give a few examples only. For example, we can cure cardiovascular disease, brain disease, ocular disease, lung disease, metabolic disorder, cancer treatment, also virus infectious disease, liver disease, and also we can make treatment for any genetic disease. There is one example of immunotherapy, cancer immunotherapy. The basic idea is that we know that T cell is the immune cell. We can collect T cells from we can collect T cells or the patients from the white blood cells, and then we can engineer so that this T cell produce this chimeric antigen receptor called CAR, and this modified T cell now will be able to detect the cancer cell and it will be able to destroy the cancer cell. Also, this T cell, as it is very active immunologic cells, when we do the organ transplantation, organ is rejected by the T cell. We can edit by ZNF or TALEN system. We can reduce the expression of alpha beta chain of this T cell receptor so that it express low of this receptor and do not reject the organ transplant. So this is helpful in graft versus host disease. And also there are very promise in lung cancer disease. In cancer, we have the T cell cancer cell detect the normal receptor PD-1. This is the death receptor, programmed death receptor, and attaching to the PD-1, cancer cell deactivate this normal T cell. So what we have done, what scientists have done, that they actually, with the CRISPR-Cas, reduce the expression of PD-1. Now cancer cells are not able to decrease the expression of these edited T cells, but T cells can now cure the cancer cells. Similarly, there are many other applications like in cystic fibrosis. Cystic fibrosis has a deletion in phenylalanine. We can actually repair this deletion mutation and can cure cystic fibrosis. Also, in case of hemophilia A, this is a X-linked recessive genetic disorder that has a mutation in B domain. We can repair the B domain and produce the pleuropotent cell, repair pleuropotent cell, and then after differentiation, the endothelial progenitor, we can put back these cells to treat hemophilia patients. So there are other diseases like Duchenne muscular dystrophy, and also there is a new hope to treat Alzheimer's disease and other neurological diseases. I'm not going to explain all. Apart from this non-communicable disease, we can also use CRISPR for communicable disease. For example, in case of HBV, we can edit the covalently closed circular DNA, which is the infectious DNA of HBV, so that it cannot undergo translation, or it can undergo degradation, so it cannot be more infectious, it cannot no longer be infectious. This is the way, it's the same way we can mutate the co-receptor of HBV so that HBV no longer can attach to human cells, so we can eradicate HBV infection. Similarly, in this pandemic, SARS-CoV-2 also tested. There is a new promise to destroy the SARS-CoV-2, not only the regular strain, also the mutated and new variants as well. So CRISPR can be also used for preventing disease. For example, we can use the gene drive for pest control, malaria control. The gene drive is a gene that actually propagates to its population. But normal way, gene drive actually propagation chance is 50%. With the help of CRISPR-Cas, when we added CRISPR-Cas to the altered allele that is propagated to population, may be deleterious to it. Maybe it may be it may make sterile to the mosquito or the pest, but it will still deliver. That is the nature of the gene drive. When we add this CRISPR to that altered allele, it cut to the wild type allele and also transferred this altered allele to the wild type allele. So now both of the allele are having the altered allele, the gene drive. So now the chance for the altered allele to its population is more than 50%. This is the way prevention of the mosquito is possible. So this is the helping, this is the way CRISPR is helping us in drug discovery. And future of this editing is that we can actually do de-extinction of the extinct animals like pigeon, woolly mammals, and ocros. For example, these woolly mammals were actually extinct animal, but we have the frozen sample from there. Scientists have taken their DNA mixed with the DNA from the skin of the Asian elephants and made pluripotent cells and put back to the ovary in the egg and trying to make this this woolly mammoth. This is the way we may resurrect the dead people, dead animal, but shall we do it? So because there are several ethical concerns on it. For example, we can make a designer baby if we want. We can make a baby with blue eyes. We can change its skin tone. But is it logical, or is it safe, or is it fair to do? Because there are many unfortunate who will not be able to undergo this process, or it may not be safe because of the off target. So there are lots of ethical concerns because of the embryo research, animal welfare, animal dignity. So what we should do, we should actually responsibly conduct the disease. So I'm ending my presentation. Thank you. Thank you for patient listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Islam, for giving us a glimpse of the applications CRISPR can have, although many of them are still ideas and yet to be pursued. Moving on, I would now move to the topic, gene editing for crop improvement in Bangladesh, key research initiatives, and we have none other than Dr. Zeba Siraj, a very, very well-respected scientist and also a close associate with us. We've been knowing Dr. Siraj for so many years. For those participants who are not aware of her, I would like to briefly introduce her. Madam Dr. Zeba Siraj is a professor at the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology in the University of Dhaka. In the morning, you heard about excellent research underway on drought-tolerant and salt-tolerant rice varieties, which has been led by Dr. Siraj. She has been a visiting scientist in Erie, U.S. Research Station in Texas, USA, and also as the Nobel Borlaug Fellow, honored with visiting research status at the University of Texas, and awarded with an Anunya Award for her scientific research. And this, I would also like to say here that this whole webinar, in fact, was initiated with the madam's idea to have a discussion on gene editing in Bangladesh. Over to you, Dr. Siraj, for your presentation.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Vibha. Thank you to the organizers, Professor Haseena Khan, Dr. Vibha, and all the others for inviting me to speak. So I'll start with, we've heard about the introduction for gene editing. So what I want to emphasize on, by using gene editing, we can actually produce non-GMO crops, which is, it could be important for Bangladesh. So if you see this on the screen, the red is the transgene, you know, when you introduce the Cas9 system and the others, the guide RNA, and the green one is the non wild type, and the yellow stands for the gene edited. So when you have a plant which is gene edited, it's transgenic because of the way you transformed it. If you self it, then out of 16 plants, you can select a plant which is non-GMO but gene edited. So that's very important. I won't go into the details because I don't have the time, but you can select for gene edited non-transgenic crops using CRISPR-Cas technology. And the other point that I wanted to mention is that now there are commercial companies which are actually producing plants which are non-GMO. So on the top panel, you can see they've used a vector, but then when they do the selection through tissue culture, they do not use, they don't go for selection so that the regenerated plants might miss the transgenic or the genes that you have inserted. But of course, they're going to select for the edited plants, and they sequence it and find the gene edited, but the non-GMO plants. And similarly, they can actually do transfection using the Cas9 and the guide RNA by using an RNP to deliver a ribonucleoprotein system to deliver it by transfection. And that also, you will not have the baggage. You will have the edited plant, but not the transgenic. So, but since there are commercial companies to do it, Bangladesh can go for it, if there's something that is desired. So the next slides that I want to show is actually for Bangladesh, yield is an issue to increase yield. So there's an example where by using gene guide RNA against this gene, which is called GN1A, it stands for grain. And you can see that in the panel, this GN1A10, it has produced greatly increased yields because you can see the number of flowers, and this is very significant. And then again for tomato, what they did is, this is a guide RNA, it targeted multiple genes in the lycopene pathway. And so if you see the stars, this is where these genes were disrupted, and the tomato produced increased lycopene, which is shown in this slide. And here you can see that some of the guide RNA or some of the mutations, they produce higher number of lycopene. So lycopene is an antioxidant and it has anti-cancer properties. So that's a very useful. And then gene editing was used for producing blast resistance in rice. Here, a transcription factor called ERF22 was targeted and it was there was a mutation in it so that it wasn't effective anymore. And the fungus uses this transcription factor to infect the plant. And as you can see, one of the plants, one of the gene edited plants has very low symptoms of the blast lesions. So this has been done. And the last example that I want to show is that wild rice, Oryza alta, this was domesticated. And you can see the domesticated, it was domesticated. I don't have the picture of the domesticated plant, but what they showed is in this paper is they reduced the gene, the seed shattering, they reduced the on length, the plant height, the grain length was better, there was stem thickness, and the heading date was made shorter so that it had more domesticated properties. And as you know, these wild rice, they have a lot of potential agronomic genes, like they might have enhanced nutritional genes. They have they're known to have abiotic stress tolerance. They're known to have biotic stress tolerance. So this is a potential for using wild rice to introduce all these properties that have been lost in commercial varieties and to make them more commercial. So then I'm going to move on to what we've done at Dhaka University in my lab. So we have used mainly for functional genomics. So this story started with when we did RNA-seq for a salt-tolerant landrace, which is called Horkuch. We did a differential RNA-seq and we identified that several transporters in Horkuch, which is a salt-tolerant landrace, were differentially upregulated or downregulated in comparison to a sensitive rice, which is IR29. So then we targeted these three transporters. So one of them is AKT1. It is downregulated under salt stress in Horkuch. And then another one, which is the 2-pore potassium transporter. This is upregulated within 2 to 3 hours after salt stress. And another transporter, which is called HAC-like, a potassium. These are all potassium transporters, but they can transport sodium as well. So this is upregulated in 24 hours. So what we went on to use CRISPR-Cas gene editing to introduce a mutation in this AKT1 gene. Because this was downregulated in Horkuch, we tried to downregulate it in IR29. And as you can see, the downregulated plant with AKT downregulation, it was more tolerant. And you can see that these plants, the genome edited plants are actually germinating in salt, in 100 millimolar salt. And at the seedling level, you can see that the gene edited plants are much more tolerant. So this was one gene. And then another, for the genes that were upregulated in Horkuch, we tried to downregulate it to see whether Horkuch becomes sensitive. And that's exactly what happened for the 2-pore potassium transporter and also for the HAC-like potassium transporter. When we did the genome editing, we downregulated the genes, we introduced mutations, and both of them were Horkuch turned sensitive. So this, just to show you what we think is happening. So AKT, when sodium is, when sodium is present more in the soil, these potassium transporters actually allow sodium leakage into the cell. So when we are downregulating AKT, sodium is reduced. And of course, during sodium chloride, the sodium is increased in the cell. So there's an osmotic and ionic imbalance. And what happens, there's depolarization in the cell membrane. During depolarization, this HAC1, this is downregulated because, as I said, it's upregulated at 24 hours. So then this 2-pore potassium transporter comes into action. And it allows the potassium ions in the vacuole to come out, and this blocks the further downregulation of potassium ion, the balance, the ionic balance, so that the membrane is no longer depolarized, and at that time, HAC1 is upregulated. So that's the and then more potassium comes in. So this is a tolerant mechanism that perhaps Horkut uses, but we need to do more work on this. So my last slide, this is actually Dr. Jimmy Botella put it much more nicely, but the current crossbreeding techniques that are in place, it takes about 8 to 10 years. So does mutation breeding, but both of them are not precise because you have to do a lot of back crossing, and still then, you know, after several years of back crossing, you might get the plant that you desire. Transgenic breeding, because of all the regulation, it also takes, because genetic engineering is precise. However, because of biosafety concerns, it still takes longer, so 8 to 12 years. And then genome editing, Dr. Jimmy Botella mentioned that he did it in 1 year, he and his group. But anyway, it can take only 4 years compared to the other technologies. So that's my last slide. Thank you so much for inviting me to speak. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Zeba. Thank you for a very nice presentation. We will come back to you once we have the panel discussion for questions. Moving on in the program, we have very important presentation now. With all these initiatives being undertaken by the research scientists for taking them to the farmers' field, there is also a requirements for, you know, for meeting various requirements, including the regulatory requirements. So we have Dr. Andrew Roberts here, who would be sharing with us requirements for taking forward these gene-edited plants in various countries. Dr. Andrew Roberts is a very familiar face in Bangladesh. He has been actively engaged in the South Asia Biosafety Program, Chief Executive Officer of Agriculture and Food Systems Institute in USA. He has a really very broad experience in agriculture biotechnology, environmental risk assessment, and food safety assessment for biotechnology, focusing on the problem formulation and also the capacity building and development of the biosafety risk assessment and regulation. Andrew leads the development and management of the AFSI's extensive international portfolio of biotechnology related programs, and therefore you will be having a first-hand view from, I know, so many activities in so many countries, and first-hand view of the global regulatory situation of the gene-edited products. So over to you, Andrew.
Thank you very much, Viba. It's a pleasure to be here. I appreciate the warm introduction, and I'm also very grateful to the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences for their role in hosting this webinar. Also, thank you to all the speakers who have spoken before me and have provided a very nice overview on gene editing, what it is, how it's done, and given us lots of ideas of the potential for the use of this technology in the future. I've modified my title. It's the same meaning, but I'm just bad at following instructions. But I think it gives you a good idea of what I'm going to be talking about, which is the status of gene-edited products, particularly plants, under regulations around the globe. Before I start, just to introduce a little bit the organization that I work for, which is the Agriculture and Food Systems Institute. We're a nonprofit scientific organization with a mission to advance science for public benefit and a focus on agriculture, food systems, and innovation. And we have a variety of programs to accomplish this, including one that I'm very proud of, which is the South Asia Biosafety Program, which we manage in conjunction with our partners at BCIL and in Bangladesh, and in cooperation with the government of Bangladesh. As a part of our policies, we always put up a declaration of interests and potential conflicts. I'm happy to report I have no conflicts related to this presentation. In the interest of disclosure, AFSI's work in South Asia is supported by grants from these organizations. So what am I going to talk about? Well, the regulatory status of gene-edited plants. And the bad news is there's a lot of change going on around the world in terms of regulatory status. Many countries have not yet made any kind of statement on how they will regulate the products of gene editing. Frankly, there's a majority of countries that in the world that don't have a functional regulatory system for genetically modified organisms. So it shouldn't surprise us too much. But what I think is worth keeping in mind is that for countries that have a functional regulatory system for genetically modified organisms, the discussions that they have around whether gene-edited organisms meet that regulatory status or whether they should be regulated as conventional products of mutagenesis are largely focused around legal issues, legal considerations, and definitions. How is the subject of regulation defined in the regulations themselves? It's typically not based on an a priori risk assessment of gene-edited organisms, although risk does enter into consideration. And again, most countries have not finalized their intention as to whether they will regulate these under GMO regulations or regulate them more consistently with products of mutagenesis. So I'm going to throw up a figure here. This is from a 2020 open access publication looking at the regulatory status of gene-edited plants around the world. In this particular figure, green means that gene-edited products will be regulated as the same as conventionally bred products of mutagenesis. Yellow is undecided, and red is places where the products have been determined to meet the definition and or fall under the regulations for genetically modified organisms. As with all such broad overviews of a global regulatory status, this is correct as far as it goes, but the details are sometimes a little bit lacking. And of course, the publication is now more than a year old. And as Jimmy was explaining in his introduction, the world of gene editing moves very quickly. So I'm going to go through a very short series of slides just to highlight what's happening in a few countries that have been thought leaders in terms of publishing their regulations and clarifying the regulatory status of gene edited plants. I can't cover everyone, but I'll try to do my best. So the first set of countries I'd like to talk about are in South America. This is Argentina, Brazil, Chile, and Colombia. And the one with hash marks is Paraguay, and I'll explain why I've added that to the map as well. The reason these are being discussed together is that they have essentially a uniform policy on the status of gene-edited products. This has been led by Argentina, which has a very progressive viewpoint in terms of establishing regulatory clarity. And they've been making a lot of effort to have diplomacy with their neighbors, particularly in South America, toward a shared understanding of the status of gene-edited products. This is based largely on some legal analysis that was done in Argentina going back about 5 years now, looking at their definition of a regulated article or an LMO. And they share the definition that's present in the Cartagena Protocol, which I think is relevant for Bangladesh because it's the same definition that's contained in the biosafety guidelines of Bangladesh. I won't go into all of the details of that definition, but in Argentina, they focused on the criteria that something is an LMO if it has been modified using recombinant DNA techniques and contains novel genetic elements. And in the opinion of the legal analysis and the regulatory authorities of Argentina, the products of gene editing that are considered SDN1 or 2 type mutations, so small mutations similar to those made in conventional breeding, do not contain novel genetic elements as defined under their legal definition and would not be regulated as GMOs. SDN3 is a descriptor for a type of gene editing which inserts a transgene. And typically, there's good agreement around the world that if you insert a new gene into an organism, that it's regulated the same way other transgenic organisms are regulated. And this is what has been agreed in Argentina, followed very shortly by Chile, most recently by Colombia. Brazil has a slightly different definition, and they've dealt with this issue in a slightly different way, but producing the same outcome. What Brazil has done is said, our Committee on Biosafety, which is CTNBO, will make a determination of each plant as it comes to us as to whether the genetic modification meets the definition of a GMO or not. To this point, and expectations for the future are that they will exempt any SDN1 or SDN2 mutations resulting from gene editing that resemble the products of conventional mutagenesis. So here we see Paraguay. I've got in hash marks. Paraguay actually has a provision that allows them to use risk assessments from either Brazil or Argentina in lieu of doing their own risk assessment, and then they make an independent regulatory decision. So while they haven't clarified their policy on gene-edited products, it's very, very likely, based on how they have structured their regulations and their inclination to follow the lead of Argentina and Brazil, that they will adopt a similar policy related to gene-edited products. I'm going alphabetically, which takes us around the world, but we continue in the Southern Hemisphere to Australia and New Zealand. And these are grouped together because they share a single food safety authority. However, in Australia, the Biosafety Authority is the Office of the Gene Technology Regulator. And they've issued an exemption for SDN type 1 mutations. These are non-directed mutations that are created using gene editing tools, including CRISPR. So those have been exempted based on the definition of gene technology that's included in the Gene Technology Act in Australia. Any template mediated, so any attempt to copy a specific known sequence, is considered gene technology and would be regulated as the same way as any other genetically modified organism in Australia. So this includes SDN type 2 mutations where a template is used to direct the DNA repair, and of course any larger cases of gene editing where a transgene is inserted. The food safety situation is a little more complex. A few years ago, FSANS, which is Food Safety Australia, New Zealand, attempted to exempt gene-edited products from their overview. This was challenged in court, and it turns out it was overturned not because it wasn't a good decision, but because FSANS isn't able to determine what it exempts from its scrutiny under their operating, implementing legislation. So what they've done instead is go back following that procedural issue and publish a review, which has now been published, with options and recommendations for how to move forward. It's clear that they're working towards an exemption for SDN1 type gene edited products. And we'll have to see how that plays out. Next is Canada. Canada has a peculiar regulatory system. It's based on not on a process trigger, so whether something is genetically modified or contains a transgene is not used to determine whether it's regulated in Canada. They base their regulations around the concept of novelty, so does a plant with this trait or a similar trait, has it been used in Canada in agriculture and in food before? So in this sense, if a novel trait is introduced using gene editing, then it's regulated under the novel trait regulations. And if a plant is created with gene editing that doesn't contain a novel trait, then it's not regulated under the novelty regulations. In Canada, prior to this, there have been examples of conventionally bred plants that are regulated as plants with novel traits, although the vast majority of conventionally bred plants are not regulated in that way. Canada has a couple of difficulties in terms of the privacy laws in Canada prevent the regulator from making a public declaration when they decline to regulate something. So there is no listing of plants that have been deemed not to possess novel traits. However, speaking with Canadian regulators and with the agriculture industry and developers in Canada, it's clear that the regulatory authorities in Canada have exempted several gene-edited products as not being plants with novel traits and then therefore declined to regulate them under their novel trait regulations. The big one, which is exceptional, certainly in this presentation and a bit of an exception in the world, is the European Union. Everybody's always very anxious to hear what the Europeans are doing. A couple of pieces of history, I think, are important for people's understanding of what's going on there. The European Union began discussing how to deal with new plant breeding techniques in 2011. And produce a report on this. This included technologies like gene editing, but it was prior to the discovery publication and the exploding popularity of the CRISPR-Cas mechanism for accomplishing gene editing. This went through a lengthy legal analysis with the which was started when a French NGO sued France as a country, asking them to make a declaration that gene-edited organisms would be regulated under Directive 2001/18/EC, which is the European GMO regulation. Very rarely does the Advocate General of the EU issue an opinion that is not taken up then by the European Commission. But that's what happened here. The Advocate General, which is the professional office that oversees these legal affairs, issued an opinion that gene-edited products were not different than conventional mutagenesis products and therefore should be exempted under the exemption for products of mutagenesis that is included in Directive 2001/18/EC. However, the European Court ruled otherwise. What's interesting about this, and it harkens back to one of the questions that was asked in the question and answer box, is the decision of the European Court was that all products of mutagenesis are GMOs under their definition. So all of the conventionally produced varieties that are grown in Europe are GMOs. Literally everything that is grown in agriculture in Europe is a GMO under this ruling. However, products that were produced from conventional mutagenesis are exempted from regulatory oversight under 2001/18/EC, whereas mutagenesis products that are produced with newer technologies, including gene editing tools like CRISPR-Cas9, do not meet this exemption because those techniques were not applied prior to 2001. So it's a bit of a bizarre ruling. It's caused a lot of controversy, particularly in the research and agriculture sectors in the EU. They are currently working to clarify how they will regulate gene-edited products under 2001/18/EC, including what kind of risk assessment will be done. There's a reasonably good report from the GMO panel describing how risk assessment is done for genetically engineered plants, transgenic plants, and which elements of that risk assessment may or may not be applied to plants that are the result of gene editing. Japan is a major importer of genetically modified crops, primarily for animal feed and for food. They don't have any cultivation of genetically modified crops in Japan. They were very early in leading these discussions, similar to Argentina. They've been very active in the international community in trying to encourage some clarity and harmony around the way these organisms are treated in international trade, because that's important to them. So in 2019, they clarified that gene-edited products would not be regulated under their Cartagena Act, which is their domestic GMO legislation. They do, however, request a pre-market consultation where developers are asked to provide some information to confirm that the product is in fact the product of gene editing, and to indicate if they have any reason to believe it might pose a risk to biodiversity. Keeping in mind that these are all products that are being imported for use in food and feed. The last country I'm going to talk about specifically and individually is the United States. It comes last alphabetically. I like to keep it last as well because the United States has a rather confusing regulatory system when it comes to biotechnology. So many of you have heard US regulators and others talk about the coordinated framework for biotechnology. This essentially says that regulatory agencies in the United States will regulate products regardless of their status as engineered or otherwise, but they will look at genetically engineered products under the same legal provisions and applying the same standards as they do for other products. What this largely shakes out to is that USDA regulates genetically modified plants with a concern around their plant pest risk associated with that plant. FDA regulates food, but they have a voluntary pre-market assessment for foods that are produced using biotechnology. And the US EPA regulates pesticides, regardless of whether they are genetically engineered, genetically modified, or otherwise. Only one of the three regulatory agencies, the three pertinent regulatory agencies in the United States, has made a statement about the status of gene-edited plants specifically, and that's USDA. They've clarified an earlier policy statement that had been in practice for a while in their revised regulations that took effect last year, that SDN1 and most SDN2 mutations are not subject to regulation under 7 CFR 340, which is the name of the regulation that's used for biotechnology at USDA. FDA has made it clear that the same voluntary consultation process that they use for genetically engineered plants is open to developers of plants using genome editing. There's only one genome edited plant on the market right now in the United States. That's a soybean. And they have been through the FDA consultation process. EPA hasn't made any policy statement regarding gene editing, but it's clear from their regulations that if they determine a gene edited plant contains a pesticide, that they would regulate it the same as any other plant incorporated protectant. And finally, just in conclusion, people have made a lot of statements about gene editing and we've learned a lot. I think just to reiterate that, gene editing encompasses a lot of molecular tools, typically to introduce targeted mutations. It's especially useful in plants that are difficult to transform and that have been challenging for conventional breeding. Dr. Batella talked about the issue of backcrossing, and that's one of the major advantages of using gene editing as a tool. The regulatory status of gene-edited plants varies around the globe, although there's some emerging consensus among non-EU members that at least SDN1 type mutations are not regulated as GMOs. And I also am always obligated to point out that it's very possible to do a risk assessment for a gene-edited plant using the same paradigm as you would use for a genetically engineered or a transgenic plant. It may not be worthwhile if you go through the assessment and you see the major elements, there are many of them that are unlikely to apply to gene-edited products. So hopefully I haven't exceeded my time by too much. Thanks again for your patience and to the other organizers of the meeting. And I'll be happy to stick around and continue to answer questions in the chat box. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andrew, for giving us a comprehensive overview of what is happening around the world on the regulations of the gene editing. And I hope this makes everyone understand that the policies are, some places policies are there and some there are developing. So now our next presentation is to understand what is happening in your neighborhood, that is India. So I am very pleased to introduce Dr. K.C. Bansal, who is the Secretary of the National Academy of Agriculture Sciences, India. Professor Bansal is an accomplished scientist of international repute, having had very, very senior positions in the Indian Council of Agriculture Research as the director of NDPGR and leading several very, very important projects. And Dr. Bansal was the first to get selected to the prestigious Norman Borlaug Chair for Crop Improvement in India. In India, National Academy of Sciences has worked on a possible framework, which is actually being followed by the government, and Dr. Bansal will be sharing the inputs from that. Over to you, sir, for your presentation.
Thank you, Vibhaji. And I'm, first of all, very sorry for all the technical hitches I've gone through. You know, but finally, I'm here through my mobile phone and talking to all of you. Well, thanks to Dr. Viba and thanks to the organizers, particularly the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences and my friends in US and Australia, you know, for joining and inviting me to this particular webinar. Well, the topic assigned to me, as you can see, is the recommended framework for regulating gene editing in plants in India. And I represent the National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, New Delhi. And you know, agricultural sciences, the National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, just like, again, Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, you know, acting as a think tank to provide all that scientifically verified options in agricultural science-related matters to the policy makers, and also to promote excellence, you know, in science in general, and attracting the younger youth and, you know, helping them promote, you know, more and more agricultural sciences in the country. And my presentation, moving further, of course, is just to remind you, the next slide, please. Just to remind you that, again, yes, we have these three categories of plants, SDN1, SDN2, and SDN3. I don't have to go into the details. Already, Jim Totella has made an excellent presentation, and I'm very happy that I could listen to his presentation after a long time. And the other message which I want to convey through this slide is particularly the SDN1 and SDN2. They do not result in any kind of novel combination of genetic elements, which we all see normally happens more and more when we talk of development of GM crops. Go to the next slide, please. And after now SDN 1, 2, and 3, we have, of course, again, Jim Botella gave an excellent account of, you know, what is happening with regard to the use of base editors and prime editors, you know, again, for improving the crop plants. And he gave several examples and you know, talked about the technology. And I'm just going to add these two in my next slide. So therefore, the total categories of plants we have. Next slide, please. The number of categories of plants now we have, which are likely to be considered for regulation, different categories. I put them into these following six categories. Of course, to start with SDN1, you know, which is induction of single point mutation or indels. Then SDN2, where we have short insertions or editing of a few base pairs by an external DNA template, you know, and that is SDN2, where we use an external DNA template, and SDN3, where insertion of a full length gene is possible. And apart from these three, of course, we have oligonucleotide dependent mutagenesis as well, which is considered equivalent to SDN2. And then we have the use of these base editors and prime editors, which I would call them as good as, you know, with regard to the regulatory parlance, we talk about it as SDN1. And next slide, please. So, you know, world over, as also just now Andy Roberts make an excellent presentation with regard to the various, you know, regulatory policy guidelines which have been developed or are in the process of development. You know, you can see here many science agencies within the government or otherwise scientific societies or national academies like ours, you know, they have been conducting these various meetings and coming up with certain documents. I don't want to go into the details of it. Of course, it started with, as also, you know, Andy Roberts mentioned, in Europe, you know, or in other countries in 2011 down to 2020. And in 2020, sometimes in May, June, July, we had the discussion of the National Academy of Agricultural Sciences. We organized a national stakeholder consultation, a roundtable discussion. Please go to the next slide. And here in this consultation, you can see, you know, we had a core committee. I'm just going to give you details about the outcome of this particular roundtable discussion we had, particularly to have a discussion on what kind of guidelines India should frame, you know, keeping in all science-based technologies and the experiences we have in the country on different crops and different, you know, areas and agroecological regions. So this particular roundtable discussion, which was organized in mid-2020, you know, was attended by a core committee, organized by a core committee, the president of which happens to be our own secretary to the Department of Agriculture, Research and Education, who happens to be also the president of the National Academy of Agricultural Sciences. And he is a expert, I would say a great expert in the area of genomics. And we, you know, several members were, you know, I had the pleasure of myself to participate. And you can see Dr. Vibha Ahuja was also a key member, you know, playing a key role in while having this kind of discussions to devise and propose a kind of a regulatory framework for genomic crops in India. And next slide, please. And you can see that this particular roundtable discussion we had a large number of discussants, you know, who are national experts in their own way in their fields of research. And apart from that, we had several industry, progressive farmers, and many other experts, like, you know, in addition to breeders and pathologists, entomologists, even including economists as well. They all participated. A wide range of discussions we had that beyond GM crops, we want to move on to develop these guidelines. What could be our framework looking like? Next one, please. But before I go into giving you the details about what is the outcome of saying, you know, you will see that in India, I just want to give an little bit of what the previous slide. Yeah, here I just want to give an account of, you know, what are the different committees regulating, you know, these genome edited or GM crops in India. Yeah, and you can see here we have, you know, Environmental Protection Act of 1986, where we have these rules. We call them as rules 1989. And under these rules, we have designated three different committees. Though there are six committees, but these three committees, like IBSC, IBSC, Institute Biosafety Committee, Institute Biosafety Committee, followed by RCGM, that is Review Committee on Genetic Manipulation. And the third is GEAC, Genetic Engineering and Appraisal Committee. Out of these six, three are the ones which are regulatory in nature. And we start with the applicant, with IBSC, which is in fact being located at the institute where this R&D is going on with regard to this rDNA technology or developing GM crops, or for that matter into pharma and other microorganisms or even environmental sector as well. So this is a single body like IBSC to start with in an institution where the work will be carried out, followed by the results to be discussed all with RCGM for further approval to taking that technology forward. And finally, commercialization and release environmentally will be governed and appraised by the GEAC, that is Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. While IBSC in the institute where work is going on, RCGM is located in another Ministry of Science and Technology, we call it Department of Biotechnology, and GEAC is located in the Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change. Next one, please. So now in this discussion, coming back to the roundtable discussion we had with our National Academy of Agricultural Sciences organized in 2020, what were the key observations? The following were the key observations, now specifically with regard to genome-edited crops. The final products, particularly SDN1 and SDN2, developed through genome editing, are free from foreign DNA, and they are also indistinguishable from the product developed through conventional breeding, utilizing natural genetic variation or induced mutation. Hence, it is not necessary, you know, and also not scientifically possible, we can discuss that point later, to regulate these products under rules 1989. Then second observation was also again, the S1 and SDN2, they do not carry any vector DNA in them and are similar to the products of spontaneous or induced mutations. And therefore, these should also be exempted from regulation and risk assessment. And how can we make it foreign DNA free? In fact, Jay Bashar has given very good example by making the cross selfing. You can, you know, because they are going to be on two different chromosomes actually, or on different locations, we can discuss that out maybe in question answer session. More importantly, that how can we make these plants to start with while the genomic, you know, that construct will be all there, but finally in our product, we won't have any of these vector bone, vector DNA or you know, any antibiotic marker gene or any foreign DNA for that matter. So therefore these should be exempted, particularly SDN1 and SDN2, you know, from regulation and risk assessment. Now, the third observation is that again, as the, you know, that they, these, their registration with the IBSC, we will start, now what protocol are we going to follow? Of course, we will have the same system in place as we have in GM crops to start with IBSC, followed by RCGM and followed by GA. But in SDN1 and SDN2, the applicant will get registered with IBSC. We have a portal, Biosafety Knowledge Portal of Government of India. They will get registered there, and Institute Biosafety Committee will take into cognizance and the kind of work which will be carried out in that particular institute. And finally, and also we'll be confirming, you know, in the final product, if there is no foreign DNA left and it is only the desired mutation with a particular trait introduced into it, you know, which is confined to only a few bases, as it will happen in case of SDN1 and SDN2 categories, then only for the matter of information, you know, the matter, it will be informed to the next level, that is our RCGM, Review Committee on Genetic Manipulation at the DBT. And beyond that, how the after the evaluation of the evaluation of the trait efficacy and the field performance, all will be carried out as per the existing, you know, non-GMO or conventional breeding varieties, which we have through Indian Council of Agriculture Research, All India Research, you know, crop improvement programs, which is going on, which is, by the way, the largest network we have in the world on several crops. Each crop, we have such a network. And so therefore, further, you know, evaluation with regard to field efficacy or the trait expression, et cetera, you know, will be as we do it with conventionally bred crops. So only with regard to IBSC and RCGM, for the matter of information, you know, these, you know, will be registered and information will be recorded. So these are actually some of the details. I have to, next slide, please. You know, in the next slide here, what we have further elaborated, you know, these particular categories of plants, for example, SDN1, you know, the same thing which I explained to you is shown here, evaluation and approval by IBSC for research to develop the mutants under contained environment. And then the product of the targeted mutagenesis, you know, which is indistinguishable, you know, through the process of non-homologous end joining or ODM, or prime editing, base editing, or any other such likely to develop to have a minimal, you know, changes in, at a single nucleotide level, they will be all considered as SDN1. Now, second category, same way SDN2 is, as mentioned before, in the middle of this particular panel, you will see that the product of targeted mutagenesis with allele replacement, and again remains indistinguishable from the natural variation which is occurring in the gene pool of a particular crop. And any such method utilized, for example, HDR, ODM or any other such method utilized will give rise to SDN2. But more importantly, what we have added another category in the SDN2 is this, that where the, again, you know, the product of these targeted mutagenesis with novel, you know, combination of genes and chimeric genes or promoter from primary and secondary gene pool, and which are indistinguishable again from, you know, from wild hybridization. Because we have certain, some of these primary from wild species or land races, you know, or interspecific crosses, you can try to have these products develop, you know, which are equivalent to SDN2. So they will also be, you know, categorized as SDN2. And SDN3 is, of course, you know, it's the same as we have got in case of GM crops technology, and it will continue to be the same as of now. That's what we, our proposal is. Now, the next slide will further go down to the level of varietal development and environmental release. The next slide, please. And here we can see, you know, the again in SDN1, I said before, review by IBSC, you know, for absence of tDNA or vector or DNA by PCR and information to the next level RCGM. In SDN2, again, same way, you know, as in case of SDN1. And SDN3, of course, I will not discuss much today, you know, SDN3, because we're considering it as good as, or as bad, if I may call it, as GM crops, you know, with regard to regulation. Now, SDN1 and SDN2, you can see the bigger bar here, you know, when it's multi-location field evaluation for trait efficacy or value for cultivation and use under, you know, we have got a system I already mentioned, you know, which is in ICAR or any other extant system for evaluation, if it comes up later, you know, will be followed. And finally, release and notification as per the legislation for the seed quality regulations. We have an India Seed Act right from 1966, and all of the related, acts will be you know, in place as we are doing it with non-GMO or with conventional bred, you know, crop varieties. Next one, please. So next one is, what are the general data requirements, particularly for genome-edited plants as proposed? I mean, this is all proposal. You know, as you would have seen, that we're not having any approval at the moment of genome-edited guidelines for either plants or animal products or for microorganisms. We are still having discussion. So therefore, these are some of the general data requirements which are proposed for, you know, genome-edited plants. Number one is target genome region, of course, will be required to be given by the researchers, the trait, targeted trait, and the vector details. Then details on programmable nuclease or Nikkei gene, if it is SDN1, 2, or 3, or prime or base editing, methods followed for genome editing, you know, I mean, basically to transfer the genes, whether it's agrobacterium or ballistic gun, then selection of genome edited plants, which kind of selective marker we're going to use later. Of course, it has to be also proved that it is absent from the final genome edited products, molecular characterization of genome edited plants to show particularly that the intended mutations only have taken place, and therefore also next is to characterization of off-target mutations. In fact, off-target, as a scientist, I'm not in particularly favor when we talk of plants, really speaking. We can have a discussion on it later. And finally, stability of edits over the generations, you know, which is, again, obtaining data, but may not be really affecting, you know, the clearance with regard to the, you know, approval of genome-edited crops. Next one, please. And finally, actually, you know, continuing with what, you know, Andy Roberts made a presentation, this is my own addition, last slide actually, is this, you know, that we need to have a look at the, you know, global regulatory landscape, you know, which is important. And to me, it appears, you know, that there should be an hybridization, and we are coming close to it at the international level with kind of a positive alignment. You know, based on, many of us are talking about case-by-case approach, that's one area, you know, where there is a convergence. Based on novel combination of genetic material, in a novel combination of genetic material, as we normally see with RDNA technology in case of GM crops, or even sometimes we can talk from the primary or secondary pool, you know, it could be still allowed, but otherwise novel combination of genetic material is not there taking place at all when we talk about SDN1 and SDN2 category of plants, then regulation based on the product rather than the process. I think it's the product which is more important. The process is only hastening the, you know, conventional plant breeding tools of a selection, phenotypic selection at the level of DNA or RNA at any time, or the expression of the gene, you know, we are talking about it. So accelerating the genetic gain or improvement of some of these crops using these, you know, latest advances and processes, but the product is the final product, which is like conventional bred, you know, crop variety. And no additional regulation if they could have been generated using conventional methods of breeding, and just no foreign DNA. So these are some of the points, I believe, where many of the countries are having a convergence on kind of agreeable terms, though there's a long way to go when we talk of global harmonization. And I say finally that global regulatory coordination is a must, you know, for sustainable agriculture innovation and for international trade. You know, we are dependent on each other with regard to the exchange of germplasm, the material, even the developed varieties, you know, for various crops, for various traits is very important. At times, you want to use them in conventional breeding programs after they have been developed through the process of genome editing. So it's important. That's what I thought, you know, while we're talking in Bangladesh, is quite fortunate, I would say, compared to India. And I would like to congratulate them for the kind of excellent work they've been doing, you know, with regard to BT, you know, Indian seed company is doing very well. And you know, more being, and even, you know, looking forward to other genome-edited crops, you know, for the welfare of the people in Bangladesh. So similarly, I feel, you know, that we together, you know, this particular webinar and many other friends coming from different countries, joining particularly from Australia and USA, if we can really strike a balance and to have, in fact, this is an opportunity which we probably will have never got again in life, you know, with the kind of technology we are talking today, that is genome editing technology, which I think to me, I talk about it once in a century or once in a lifetime opportunity for our, all of us to use it fully for the benefit of smallholder farmers, particularly in a country like India. So with this, friend, thank you. Thank you very much, all of you, for this opportunity. Thanks to you, Dr. Vipa, and to friends in Bangladesh for inviting, for making this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for giving an overview of efforts by the National Academy of Agriculture Sciences. And I would just like to supplement here that the efforts by the NAS have been really instrumental in framing the policies in of the various, not only the now the gene-edited plants, but various other products in India. And so the Bangladesh, this initiative of Bangladesh Academy of Sciences can also, you know, really take a big, can be a really a baseline for a similar policy interventions in Bangladesh. Thank you, sir.
Sure, I would recommend that. I would recommend that strongly that Bangladesh to have similar policy document prepared. Yeah, sure. And we would be very happy to help them if whatever kind of coordination, collaboration they require. Thank you, Vipa. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Our next component is the panel discussion on the need for enabling policies for use of gene editing in Bangladesh. We have very senior academics, all the senior academics who are from the reputed institutions in Bangladesh who would be making their interventions on these specific programs. But I've just been informed that Dr. Zahirul Karim, a vice president of the BAS, who was supposed to share his views with us in the end, has to leave for some urgent work. And I would request Dr. Karim, before leaving, to kindly share your views, and then we will proceed with the panel discussion. Dr. Karim, sir.
So yeah, I can be here and I can make my statement after the panel discussion.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Then we will proceed with our panel discussion. As I mentioned, we have the four participants, four senior professors from the reputed institutes in Bangladesh. I will just give their names. Dr. Mirza Hassan Usman, a professor in the Sher-e-Bengal Agriculture University and fellow of the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences. Dr. Tamina Islam, Department of Botany, assistant professor in Department of Botany in University of Dhaka. We have Dr. Aparna Islam, professor in the BRAC University, and Dr. Mohammad Tofasal Islam, professor in the Department of Biotechnology, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman Agriculture University, Ghazipur. I would request all of you to make a short 3 to 4 minutes interventions, and then we can pick up more questions from the chat box if it comes to that. Dr. Mirza Hassan Usmanji, I have a small intervention from you, which I'm requesting. Agriculture is facing numerous challenges, as we heard in the beginning itself from our president of the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, and more than ever before, particularly the concerns of the climate change. And there is definitely a need for novel strategies, which has been stressed. What do you think is the role of gene editing tools that we heard just now, developing technology across the world for addressing these challenges in Bangladesh?
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. And first of all, I would like to thank Bangladesh Academy of Sciences for arranging such a time-demanding webinar. And thanks for the presenters. We came to know about many interesting facts about genome editing. As you know, it is nowadays genome editing is a very popular tool for crop improvement. As you know that in animal and human, it is already implemented very well for drug development. And one of our presenters has already mentioned about their potential application in healthcare and so on. And this is a precise modification of plant genome for crop improvement. But as you know that due to climate change, Bangladesh is suffering from various kind of environmental stresses like salinity, drought, high temperature. So in case of agriculture, we have to develop such tolerant varieties So as you know that stress tolerance is multigenic. So in that case, genome editing would be a potential tool. But you know that crop improvement is a multidisciplinary work. You know, a plant physiologist, molecular biologist, biochemist, they should work together. So as you know, in many countries, like China is leading, followed by US and Japan. So they are already they have commercialized some of the crops using genome editing. So now we have to think about climate resilient crop varieties using our genome editing techniques. And fortunately, many of our researchers and also some of our Bangladesh Academy of Sciences fellows, like Professor Hasina Khan, Professor Jebaisan Shiraz, and Professor Tibatul Islam, also they're working on crop improvement. Already they have developed some interesting methods. But today's webinar is about policy. What would be our next policy for science, for the implementation of these technologies, and for the commercialization of those genome edited crops? So in that case, we have to develop a very, very clear guidelines. And also we have to promote science for the sustainable development, and all of the technologies should be sustainable, and they should go directly to the farmers' field. And we should not only focused on the improvement of yield, but also the quality, and also other value-added products like improvement of secondary metabolite in some plants, some medicinal plants. We have, we can enhance their medicinal properties. And finally, we have to go for the commercialization of those products. So finally, I would like to thank you for inviting me in this webinar as panelist, and thank you for your active participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for giving these, sharing these ideas. We would move on to Dr. Tamina Islam. Dr. Tamina, a wealth of genetic data is now available due to advances in the genome sequencing technologies. Can you share your views on how this data can be coupled with these tools for use by plant breeders to achieve the goals that could not be reached through traditional breeding? As we just heard, you know, that there is numerous opportunities that can be exploited. Over to you.
Yeah. Thank you. Of course, I can answer that. Before that, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me as a panelist of this esteemed panelist group, which is an honor for me. So moving to the question that you have asked me, yes, as we all know that genome sequences data, because of the advancement of recent technologies, it's, there are a lot of data, are sequence data are available nowadays. So we know the genome sequence data gives us a wholesome idea about an organism. For example, the genetic information, which stretches of the DNA, contains the gene, which contains the regulatory instruction, etc. That are the main factors for in case of genome editing. Nowadays, genome editing is very well known because of its precision in altering genetic components within a short period of time. Without any clear information about the gene or its sequence, editing will be, you know, quite impossible for us. For successful editing, I must say that we must know the exact location and also the sequence of our target gene in order to construct a vector. Although there are several examples, I would say, from the traditional breeding system, but there are a lot of drawbacks of this traditional or conventional breeding system as well. For example, Professor, if I talk about Professor Jebaisam Shira's presentation, on her presentation, she put up a very beautiful slide regarding the time, mentioning how much time it takes for the traditional breeding system for mutation breeding and versus the CRISPR-Cas or the genome editing tools and everything. On the other hand, I must mention about the mutation breeding drawbacks over here as well, because traditional breeding or mutation breeding has been done through the EMS mutations or EMS system. So that comes with a lot of background mutation load. So in that case, you can really mute it or get your desired phenotypes, but it takes a lot of time. Like it takes a lot of time, and also there are a lot of background mutations load. So desire to select the desired mutation or desired phenotype, it's very difficult for us. And although not only the desired phenotype or desired trait has been changed, along with that, some other genes or the off targets can be also found. So that is another drawbacks of the conventional breeding system. But lastly, I must mention about the another drawbacks of this traditional breeding system about the seed, because we can't really save the seeds for further generation, as the improved traits that have been developed through the traditional breeding segregate each generation according to the Mendel segregation system, which in turn actually increase the dependency of the farmers to the company. So these are the major drawbacks for the traditional system, if I mention. All these problems can be solved through the genome editing tools. For specifically, I will mention some examples as well. In that case, in case of genome editing, we choose, or the scientists basically choose the very selectable, through the selectable system, they really select the specific mutants for that, and which is a very stable one. So it's very, very, very precise, I would say. And also the traditional, if you talk about the precision, so in case of traditional breeding, you will not, this is not to be, you know, nowhere to be very precise editing into them, not the editing, precise trait change into the phenotypes. But that is the beauty of CRISPR-Cas, I would say, the precision. So precision is the beauty of traditional breeding, CRISPR-Cas breeding. So you can really select any targeted gene and where you can change, or you can edit or select any phenotype. I must mention, like Professor Jebba Islam Shiraz and also Dr. Jimmy Voltella, yes, he mentioned a lot of examples regarding the CRISPR-Cas editing. Those are the very nice examples, but I would mention another example that might interest Professor Dr. Khalil Islam as well, because there is a disease called Konzo, which is a neurological disease caused by a toxic compound, cyanogenic glucosides, in cassava, that affected a large proportion of the African people. So that can be, that already mentioned here, that it is reported that can be cured now because of the genome editing by CRISPR-Cas. What they have done, they have mutated or targeted two specific genes, CYP79D1 and CYP79D2. These two genes were targeted and in a knockout experiment. So they are successful of curing this disease. So that is a very good example from that. And regarding that, I must conclude here with this information also, that even though with the CRISPR-Cas as well as now the base editing and the prime editing has also come to the scene. So these are very, very precise. Apart from the mutation or alteration, nowadays it is also possible with the CRISPR-Cas system, you can activate any gene, you know. So that is another thing. So not only the knockout mutations or not only the knocking out of any gene, you can also activate a gene as well. So these, that means we have all the controls in our hand to control or to design or for the future crops. If I remember correctly, Dr. Amir Hassanizaman mentioned about the climate resilient crops and other crops that we need in future for in case of Bangladesh. I'm very glad to inform you that Dhaka University at the Department of Botany, we also already started working on that way. Not only the climate resilient crop, also regarding, he also mentioned about to increase the secondary metabolites or to improve any trait. We also started targeting some genes that could be helpful for reducing some toxic compound from the plants as well. So to conclude, I would say that genome sequence data that gives us the blueprint where we can edit according to our needs without going through different trails or errors, unlike the conventional breeding. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tamina, for your comments. I'll move on to our third panelist, Dr. Aparna Islam. She's a professor in the Brock University and the leading biosafety expert, very familiar with the biosafety regulations and guidelines in Bangladesh. I've been seeing in the chat box also that there is a, and also the speakers stressed the need for a regulatory policy framework for gene editing in Bangladesh. So Dr. Islam, we heard from our previous speakers that there is many, particularly the Dr. Andrew Roberts, that various countries are adopting different approaches. There appears to be, although there are variable approaches, but there appears to be a growing consensus in many countries that genome editing that results in the introduction of simple mutations or small insertions may not be subjected to additional regulations and be treated in the same way as the traditional breeding, products of the traditional breeding approaches. Okay, may I ask you to share your views on how these products of gene editing can be regulated within the Bangladeshi framework, and also your views on particularly the SDN1 and SDN2 methods.
Thank you, Dr. Vibha. And first, I also like to thank the organizer, Bangladesh Academy of Science, Professor Hasina Khan and Professor Zeba Islam Sharad, especially, and other organizers for calling me. We all know that Bangladesh has signed the Cartagena Protocol on Biosafety in 2000, and then it was ratified in 2004. Our first guideline, which came in 1999, was updated after that in 2008. We also know without doubt that Bangladesh is an agriculture-based country, and our agriculture productivity is facing lots of challenges, which is increasing with time. The intensity of the problems are getting more rigorous. So now, how to overcome that? Of course, gene editing is a process to overcome these yield loss and improvement, achieve these improvement. And as we have heard from the previous speakers, gene editing, whenever it is talked about, we sometimes relate this with mutation, and we relate it with transgenic crop or GM crop. The last presentation clearly established that this gene editing can be divided into three categories, SDN1, 2, and 3, and 1 and 2, which is actually an extension of the mutation breeding, which is a type of new breeding technique, which we call NBT, where precise genetic changes are accomplished. And if we look into how the world is, different countries of the world is treating this gene editing, we can see from Andrew's presentation that many countries have taken a very practical view on keeping in mind that these plants, how they, the process which has been used to do this editing, it has been considered. And according to that, these plants coming under the category SDN1 and 2, the mutation. And they are actually cannot be distinguished from the conventional breeding or the mutation technique. Now we come to the scenario of Bangladesh. Our regulatory is governed by the definition of GMO and LMO, which is similar under the Cartagena Protocol on Biosafety. According to the protocol, the LMO is any living organism that possesses a novel combination of genetic material. And so the definition of LMO clearly indicates that SDN1 and 2 category do not fall under the definition of LMOs, as there is no new gene inserted. Similar interpretation have been made by many other countries, where they have determined that SDN1 and 2 does not result in creation of novel yield. Under this, I'm sorry for the noise outside. So under this background, therefore we can also take a similar approach, saying that in Bangladesh, we can adopt a policy where SDN1 and 2 category of gene editing plant need not to be treated as the same way as the GMO. Rather, it should be treated as conventional breeding, which means that these type of plants should be regulated by the existing legislation for conventional breeding and mutation, which might be under the Ministry of Agriculture at the moment. So that is my view regarding it. And if we consider consider SDN3, that will be different from the SDN1 and 2. And I very recently, Japan has also approved a tomato, which has approved because it is not an insertion, which is not a result of the insertion of a foreign DNA, rather a small mutation. So we can take an example from these countries and we can proceed accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you, Aparna. Thank you so much. And now we have our final panelist, Dr. Tafizul Islam. Dr. Islam, as we heard, you know, from the people, I mean, from our experts, there is a lot of potential. There is a, you know, this technology has a, you know, we have the technology interventions going on in the country also in Bangladesh. So we would like to hear from you what is needed here to build local capacities, what kind of partnerships, what kind of capacity building initiatives, particularly to identify the opportunities where this technology can contribute to deal with the local problems, to help meet the needs of the farmers and consumers. And also, very importantly, move smoothly through the, you know, through the commercialization process. Over to you. With your extensive experience, I've heard you many times. It's nice to you know, hear from you, your views here.
Thank you so much, Dr. Biba Ahuja, Andrew Roberts, Aparna, and Jeva Islam Shiraz. We met in several occasions, and this topic of webinar organized by Bangladesh Academy of Science, South Asia Biosafety Program, and Agriculture and Food System Initiative. I appreciate all of the organizers and those who worked behind this organization for this excellent program. And in this program, I saw more than 150 participants. They attended a very excellent overview on different you know, potentials of CRISPR-Cas genome editing or other genome editing technologies, including the regulatory aspects. What I understood from the lectures, as well as discussion from the highly qualified panelists, we can utilize this very revolutionary technology in our agriculture, because Bangladesh agriculture is now aiming to achieve food and nutritional security of ever-increasing population of this country by making agriculture profitable and sustainable. And this statement is, you know, written in the National Agriculture Policy, which has been passed by the Parliament in 2018. The statement is very straightforward. And in the past, Bangladesh, you know, did outstanding job in agricultural research to, you know, achieve nearly food sufficiency, especially in the cereals. But the problem is, as Dr. Hasanuzzaman mentioned, and other panelists and researchers mentioned, that Bangladesh is one of the most climate vulnerable country. And this is why very biotic and abiotic stresses are posing a serious threat to our agricultural productivity. Another big issue is that we have very limited land area. Every year we are losing 1% of cultivable land. So in this context, the genome editing technology, especially the CRISPR-Cas methods, which is evolving very fast since its first discovery in 2012 by Jennifer and Emmanuel. And I think this technology is becoming day by day user-friendly as well as very robust. You can see in my background a book, CRISPR-Cas Methods. This is the second volume of the book I am editing, which has been publishing by Springer publisher. What I enjoyed over editing this book, the method is really, you know, moving very fast and becoming user friendly. But the, in reality, in Bangladesh, we are yet to utilize this technology in the practical field. Bangladesh has one, you know, GM crop in the real field, in the farmer's field. But in case of CRISPR-Cas method, in my laboratory, we collaborated with Sufian Kamaun, who was one of the first user of CRISPR-Cas technology in plant. He is based in the Sainsbury Laboratory, UK. We tried to edit 10S genes of wheat to develop a blast-resistant wheat variety. You know, in 2016, Bangladesh experienced a severe epidemic of wheat blast, which decreased our 15% wheat production. And Bangladesh is now one of the top five wheat exporting country. So in our experience, in case of wheat, we also used, you know, this concept in barley. In case of diploid barley, we found immune plant against the wheat blast disease. But in case of wheat blast fungus, wheat lines, we screened 7,000 lines edited by CRISPR-Cas9 method. We found only 20 moderately tolerant plant. Because in case of wheat, you know, every gene has six copies, and the method is not yet, I think, you know, optimized or tuned to be used by any laboratories like PCR method. But it is, you know, moving very fast. I think at this moment, we can, you know, train the young peoples, those who are working in the molecular biology, especially India. Some Indian scientists, they are much ahead than us. Even in our country, Dhaka University Professor Jaba Islam Shiraz, and in BRI, Bangladesh Rice Research Institute, some researchers, they have started work and received training in China. So at this stage, we need to train, you know, next generation biotechnologists on this, you know, frontier technology. I would like to share one success story in our case. When we experienced wheat blast fungus, the big problem was there was no precise diagnostic tool. Dr. Khademul nicely mentioned that this method is very, very efficient in developing a rapid, convenient, and specific diagnostic tool. In collaboration with USDA scientists and Chinese Academy of Science, we developed a rapid detection method of wheat blast pathogen using genome-specific markers and Cas12-mediated technology. And this technology is just like, you know, a pregnancy strip, you know, in case of coronavirus. The PCR strip, it takes 30 minutes. In our case, wheat blast, it is already validated in the field condition. So we are expecting, and this is also our duty, I think the policymakers who are involved here, how can we, you know, scale up this technology to the real life, especially in the quarantine office. After Bangladesh experienced wheat blast, Zambia also experienced wheat blast, and both country experienced wheat blast originated in South America. So there is a high chance of, you know, spread of wheat blast in India. India is producing 105 million tons of wheat, and second highest wheat producing country. China, number one in the world, wheat producing country. So if we can deploy this technology in all quarantine offices, that would be really that would be really a big impact. So I would like to, you know, end my talk by asking the organizers, especially Bangladesh Academy of Science, because Dr. Casey Bansal, he nicely shared the Indian experiences. They made the papers to recommend the policymakers for their approval. We may take the lead, especially Bangladesh Academy of Science, in collaboration with other international experts, including India and other organizations, we can prepare our paper based on experiences in other countries, including India, to propose our regulators to adopt this technology. Because in case of GMO, Bangladesh is champion, in fact. Bangladesh has standard protocols and standard, regulations. But in case of, gene editing, edited products, we have no. I am a member of National Core Committee for Crop Biotechnology. Several times I raised this question, but they said if there is no transgene, then we have no need to be worried. But we need to have, papers. We need to have, some officially approved regulations. Then I am sure in near future, as people have huge, curiosity, young people, I traveled across the country and talked too much since 2016 about CRISPR-Cas methods. So we need now to go for some action. One is regulatory, another is to empower or enhance the capacity of young biotechnologists to use this technology for various purposes, not only crop improvement. It can be used in diagnostic, domestication of crops, basic research, and even it can be used to create biodiversity, which has been lost due to classical breeding. Thank you very much for allowing me a long time. And I am talking at the end. This is why the participant is now around 100. I should not go more. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your very, very nice recommendations. I'm sure we will, at Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, they will look at your recommendation to come out with papers. And, we will not be taking any more questions from the chat box because we are running over time. And I am thankful to our speakers, who have answered actually live to most of the questions that were raised in the chat box. I'll move on to our last, this one. And Professor Dr. Zurul Karim, we have Vice President of Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, who have very patiently, sir. We are sorry we ran over time, and thank you for staying back with us. Professor Karim is the former Executive Chairman of the Bangladesh Agriculture Research Council and former Secretary of the Ministry of Fisheries and Livestock of the Government of Bangladesh, currently Vice President of BAS, as I mentioned. Sir has contributed to the numerous committees, task forces, commissions, such as National Agriculture Commission, which have studied the problems of agriculture development, education, and sustainable environmental development. We've had these discussions on this very, very interesting novel tool, which can solve some of these problems. And I will give the floor to Dr. Karim for his closing remarks, as well as guidance on moving forward this particular issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Vaibha. Actually, you have given a wonderful introduction, and I must thank you. I joined a little bit later because I was in the Ministry of Environment, and they were discussing an issue where I was present, and this was related to some of the issue of gene and biodiversity loss and those issues. In fact, I requested the Director General and his office to participate. I don't know whether he has participated. We had become a little late joining in this meeting. Madam, actually, I was enjoying the presentation, at least six presentations probably before panel I could hear. And these were wonderful and made very good advancement on the area of gene editing. In fact, gene editing, it has very wide opportunity for a new area not being used in many countries. There's opportunity for teaching, for working on science, on technology transfer, diagnosis, as well as in the food safety requirement and food nutrition and improvements. So it has enormous opportunities. I just come to the point on one of the methods that CRISPR has, which Javashiras presented very briefly, but she made a long presentation in an academy lecture. And from there, actually, we are all feel encouraged that it should be discussed and some of the regional country opportunities should be shared. Probably this is the opportunity that we have today. And from the presentation, actually three presentations, we like to quote. One is Andrew Robert. He gave an excellent global overview on the regulatory system. In fact, nothing will work without a good regulatory system. And this takes long time because it's involved the different tier of the people and different departments, ministries, and across the people and down to the farmers. So this presentation is very good. And I think the knowledge is provided from this, from his presentation could be shared by the Bangladeshi scientists and by the regional scientists in order to go further on it. From his presentation, I could see there are countries who has already commercialized the gene editing in some crops, and some country are not yet started either testing or this. So actually there are wide gap, and some country are restricting the regulations on testing and popularizing on the technology. Now in Bangladesh, the situation is different. We are open. We like to welcome any technology which are good for human being and good for the environment. Now, for inviting those technology, we must have to have a sound regulatory system. And for the regulatory system, my first request is that we can have a regional network form. Why not? The India presentation is by Kasi Barmal, is shared by all of us, and this should be the base information for other country to discuss and to develop. So a network could be formed and this could be shared and we can develop further. Because finally, it must go to the policymaker and they will take it to the parliament where it would be, there should be act on that. And for this, sound knowledge and wide informations are required. So he suggested a global regulatory coordination system. I'd say, let us start first the regional regulatory coordinator system, the country around us. And that's not only the coordination on the regulatory system. They can share also the capacity building, because many countries are lagging much behind and some of these are far advanced. So capacity building could also be shared. And the academy, Bangladesh Academy of Sciences, Indian Academy of Sciences, and other countries, the Academy of Sciences and universities, they can share and join the opportunity and develop further. I like to mention another point, and that CRISPR-Cas, I think Java mentioned that it could produce non-GM products. I think if that could be done quickly, it will have no barrier to reach to the farmer and to increase productivity. And in some cases, the improve intensification for the area where unfavorable ecosystem is there. So actually climate smart or climate resilient agricultural practices is definitely required and where the technology could provide much more. I thank all of you. I enjoyed the panelists, their opinion, and this all could be shared in the network by the academics when we were discussing and work further. I thank you very much, and thank you, Vibha, for sharing a very nice session all through. And I hope this would be very fruitful, and we shall take next course of action from it, because this way forward begins from this webinar. So thank you very much. See you again, and we discuss further. All the best.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for your closing remarks. We are really impressed by your opinion and willingness to take forward the results of this particular webinar. We, on behalf of the SABP, AFSI, and BCIL, I extended that, you know, we would be very pleased to continue to work with the Bangladesh Academy of Sciences on anything that is required to make use of this wonderful technology. With this, I think close the webinar, and may I request Professor Hasina Khan to maybe say something, and then we could just close it. Madam?
Thank you, Dr. Weber. That was it generated a lot of interest, this webinar. I'm so happy about it, that we got to organize this together. I think we have a few recommendations which have been recorded, and we at the Academy will work on how we can implement those recommendations together with the region and with the other countries in the world. So this is something which especially we have this project for poverty alleviation, and this is very related to that, and we will be discussing this soon in a meeting, so we'll take up these recommendations very strongly. Thank you so much, Deva. I don't have anything else to share at the moment, but we will be in touch, and whatever more we discuss, we will perhaps work on it further. Thank you.
Sure. And in the last, I would say, thank all the speakers and all the participants. We have around 100 people still with us. And thank you for so much of interest. And with this, we close the webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.